Okay, so how is everyone today? Good, I hope. I noticed that attendance is marginally better on days when homework is due. So it's good to see some of you. I mean, it's good to see all of you. I just mean those of you who had other things to do the last time. Okay, so last time we were talking about absolute value inequality, so let's talk about those just briefly. So how about absolute value of 4x minus 3 divided by 6 greater or equal to 7? So we want to solve something like this. So there's kind of two ways to think about this. One of them is with a picture. I'll go ahead and draw a picture. So what is the characteristic shape of absolute value? A V. So somehow there's a V. And then that's y equal to absolute value, something or other. And then there's y equal to 7, that's a horizontal line. So somehow this problem and a picture that looks like that are related to each other. Alternatively, besides the picture, or to help you remember what the picture is about, is consider. Is there anything in principle that I could reveal so that this inequality would be true? How about a 7, or an 8, or an 8 million? Right? Any of those would be fine. But a six wouldn't work. Okay. So, but 6 million would work, right? So how about going the other direction? What else could work? A negative 7 could work. And so could a negative 7 million. A negative 10 would work. So there's kind of two pieces from which solutions can be drawn. So you can think of this as saying something like, well, I need, whatever I'm revealing needs to be big enough. It either needs to be big enough positive or big enough negative. Okay? So the switchover occurs at the sevens. Which is to say, you need to be big enough. You need to either be greater or equal to 7, which is to say you might be in that piece, or you need to be less or equal to negative 7, which is to say you could be in that piece. Okay, and then when we tried to put a phrase to this style of question, the phrase that we put to it was something like, well, the answer is going to be everything outside the sevens. Okay. So then, the first step in solving this exercise is to say that, well, it must be the case that the thing inside of the absolute value must be less or equal to negative 7, or the thing inside of the absolute value must be greater or equal to positive 7. And what I want you to understand is that this piece corresponds to the left side. That is to say that whatever you're putting into the absolute value has to be big enough in the negative sense, or big enough in the positive sense. So now, once you get to this position, it's just sort of turn the crank. The algebra just sort of falls out from here. But is there any question why you must get to this position in the first place? Is there any question how you get here? So from here, it's just turn the crank. Okay, so then it'd be 4x
minus 3, less or equal negative 42. Now we'll add 3, so 4x, less or equal to negative 39. And then divide by 4, x less or equal to what? Negative 9.75.
Okay, any question about that calculation?
Or. Okay, multiply by 6, so 4x minus 3 greater or equal to 42, add 3. 4x greater or equal to 45, so x greater or equal to 11 and a quarter. So it's saying that you have to be less or equal, you have to be on that piece or that piece. So you have to be big enough but in the negative direction, or big enough in the positive direction. So any question about this exercise? Okay. The other style, or another style, is how about 3 minus 2x divide by 5 is less or equal to 8.
So in comparison to the previous exercise where we said that on the previous exercise we said that it's going to be outside the sevens, what's this one going to be? Inside the eights, between the eights. So let's make sure that we cover our bases, right? So in principle, is there anything I could reveal that could make this true? Yeah, right? 8 would work. 7 would work. Negative 3 would work. There's a bunch of things that would work. 10 won't work. Now, similarly, I'm gonna make a slight modification and then erase it. How about this? So that's now negative 8. In principle, could this be solved? Is there anything that I could reveal that would satisfy this inequality? No, right? Because there's nothing that you could put into the absolute value so that something less or equal to negative 8 would come out. Okay. So again, as a picture, the case that looks like between the eights. So, what is the first algebraic step that I need to write? That, by analogy to this one, what do I need to write here? So I'd like to point out what is apparently the happy circumstance, okay, that this one can be written so succinctly. Notice that this one seems to be more verbose, right, the one above, than this one. Why is it that this one can be written more succinctly than that one? Yeah, because there's no gap, right? This is a single piece, whereas that's two pieces. That one corresponds to that piece, that one to that piece. There's just one piece in the present exercise. So, negative 40, less or equal to 3 minus 2x,
less or equal to 40. That's multiplying all positions by 5. Now subtract 3. Negative 43 less or equal to negative 2x less or equal to 37. So far, so good. And now just a little bit of funny business occurs. What funny business?
Divide by negative.
Okay, we're going to divide by negative 2. Okay, so negative 43 divided by negative 2, that's the left position. The middle position is x. Very good.
So it is a fine thing to divide inequalities by negative numbers. That's fine. But when you do that, you must flip the direction of the inequality.
So the negatives cancel, then 43 over 2 is 21.5. Greater or equal to x, greater or equal to negative 18.5.
Okay. Any question about this one? Okay, so we've got to be comfortable with this because now we're going to do, there's just a couple of techniques in this class that are difficult. So the one that we're about to do is probably the most difficult. If not the most difficult, then the second most difficult thing that you'll do in all of college algebra. So are we ready for it? As ready as we're going to get, huh? So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to solve an inequality incorrectly because I want you to observe exactly where and how solving an inequality can go wrong, and I want you to see how it can go wrong, and then we'll have to say, okay, there's got to be some other way where we can never make this kind of mistake.
So suppose that you say solve 2x plus 5 divided by x minus 10 less or equal to 1.
10. Okay. So I'm going to be careful at first, at least, and say, okay, I'm going to find the natural domain. So what's the natural domain of this inequality?
Everything but
10. And just as a reminder, what natural domain is the set of all x's that, in principle, you could evaluate the inequality at, and without regard to whether or not the inequality is true or false. So you can evaluate this inequality at any x except 10. And we want to find all the places where it's true. Okay.
So suppose we move directly to the algebra. Now, the algebraic steps. So I'm going to solve it the way most students try to solve it, especially ones who don't come to lecture. So I'm going to take that, and I'm going to say, okay, I remember doing something like this with equations, so I'm going to do x minus 10. Both sides.
So the purpose being is so I can cancel the x minus 10 on the left hand side.
Okay. So the new right hand side is x minus 10. The new left hand side is 2x plus 5.
Now what?
About subtract 5. If you subtract 5, then you have 2x less or equal to x minus 15.
Now what?
Subtract an x. So x less or equal to negative 15.
Okay. So our answer at present is saying that, well, if you plug in negative 15 or anything less, the inequality ought to be true. Well, let's think about that for a moment.
Just for fun, let's check that out and see if that's right. Check. So let's check x is negative 15.
How do you check, by the way? By plugging it in, right?
So 2 times negative 15 plus 5, and then divided by negative 15 minus 10, less or equal to 1.
Okay, 2 times negative 15 is negative 30, and then add 5,
negative 25.
And then negative 15 minus 10, that's negative 25. So how about this? Is that true?
1 less or equal to 1?
That's good. We like that. Let's be double extra sure and choose something to the left of negative 15. So what's something to the left of negative 15? Even further negative. Okay, negative 20. And this ought to work, right? Because we're saying that x needs to be less or equal to negative 15. So this ought to work.
So 2 times negative 20, and then add 5. And then negative 20, and subtract 10, less or equal to 1.
Well, 2 times negative 20, that's negative 40. Add 5, that's negative 35.
Negative 20 minus 10 is negative 30.
And then the negatives cancel, the 5s cancel,
and you obtain the inequality 7 over 6, less or equal to 1.
How about that? That's false. But wait a second. Wait a second. Our work said that that ought to work. Right? That's what it looks like. So what went wrong? It's a little subtle.
When you multiply by x minus 10.
When you multiply. Okay. Could you be? What's the only time that the red could be 0? If x were 10. But we said, nah, we're not talking about 10s. Those are out. But it does. So
it could be multiplied by a negative, and then you'd have to switch the sign.
Ah, right? So look. So in the first place, this step and that step are fine. Because adding something to both sides is always permissible. That always preserves the truth. But look at this red multiply both sides. If x were 100, then these would be 90s, right? And we'd be multiplying both sides by 90. That'd be fine. But if x were, say, 1, then 1 minus 10, that'd be negative 9. These would be negative 9s. And that's fine too. Except when you multiply both sides by negative 9, what? You have to switch the direction of the inequality. So this step right here is broken. You can't do it. You can't do it because you have lost account of the SIG and of x minus 10. You just don't know what it is. You're assuming that it's positive because you didn't switch the direction of the inequality. So here's the problem. So what we need is we need a method that such that we'll never fall into this kind of error. Okay, so does everyone see that in the first place, here's an inequality and it has been solved incorrectly. And that's exactly where the error is. So that's exactly what we need to avoid. Okay. So now I'm going to solve this inequality, and it's going to be, like I said, probably either the first or second most complicated technique you'll do all in all of college algebra.
Okay. So solve. Two x plus 5 over x minus 10 less or equal to 1.
So we got the first step right last time, and that is, yes, you must consider the natural domain.
And yes, it is everything except 10.
Now, the thing that we went on to do from here is we went on to do some algebraic operations. And the place we went into error is we started multiplying both sides by expressions that we didn't know the sign of.
So now we're going to do something else. We're going to say, okay, this is going to be called the zero and simplify step. Specifically, we're going to take the given inequality,
observe that neither side is zero. That side is whatever it is that's not zero, and that's one which isn't zero. So now we're going to move all of the terms to one side. And then once we've done that, zero will be on the other side. So I'm going to move this one to the left.
So that we have 2x plus 5 over x minus 10 minus 1 is less or equal to zero.
So that's what I meant by zero. So now, to simplify, what I want you to do is I want you to take the other side that's not zero, and I want you to write it as simply as possible. So in particular, this is the difference of two fractions, right? This being construed as 1 over 1. I want you to write this as a single fraction. Okay, so find a common denominator, etc. So what do?
Very good. So 2x plus 5 over x minus 10. Right, you can do the butterfly or cross multiply or whatever other method that we've gone over. So this would look like x minus 10 minus 10 over x minus 10 less or equal to 0.
Now they have a common denominator.
Now the subtraction can be performed.
And then when you perform the subtraction, what is the numerator?
X plus 15, right? Because there's two x's and then minus one x. So there'd be just one x. And then there's 5 minus negative 10. Well, that's 5 plus 10, which is 15. And then over x minus 10 less or equal to 0.
So this
is what I meant by simplify.
Okay. question about getting to here. I'd like for you to observe. Please count for me. How many times did we multiply both sides of an inequality by something? 0 times. So it is literally impossible that we have made the mistake that we made on the previous page so far. Next step. Now we're going to solve the corresponding equation. So what I mean is that at the end of this step, we had an inequality. Now we're going to take this inequality and write it, and we're going to copy it exactly, except instead of writing the inequality sign, we're going to write equal.
So x plus 15 over x minus 10 equal 0.
And I want you to solve this. Well, we already know the natural domain, because the natural domain of these two must be the same. So what are we going to do?
Multiply by x minus 10. Okay. But wait a second. I thought we just got finished on the last page
noting how dastardly and wrong multiplying x by both sides by x minus 10 was. Why are we doing it now? It's not an inequality anymore. Do you need to worry about switching the direction of this equation? No, that's not even a thing, right? It's not even a thing. Inequalities have a direction, but equations don't.
Okay, so then if we do this, then that's the equation, and this is the answer.
Okay, any question about getting there? Step 4.
Now this method is named after step 4. Step 4 is called sign chart. So what we're going to do is we're going to plot a number line. And we're also going to plot breaks in the natural domain . Those come from step 1 . And we're also going to plot solutions to the equation . Those come from step 3 . Okay, so here's a number line.
How many breaks were there in the natural domain? One. How many solutions were there to the equation? One.
So we're going to plot those, and I'm going to plot them as fence posts, like this. So they were 10 and negative 15.
So someone please say it. But we found 10, and then we found 15, negative 15, right? So we plot 10, and then negative 15. Okay, is the error clear, right? The number line does not care what order you found your things in.
However, I observe it all the time that students, whatever order they happen to have found things in, that's the order that they plot them on the number line.
Okay. So now,
within each region, we're going to choose a test point
So that's the first thing. So let me be clear about what that means. What that means is that in each of these three regions, 1, 2, 3, I want you to choose an x value that resides in there. So what's something to the left of negative 15? Negative 20. What's something between negative 15 and 10? 9 is the first thing I heard. 0 also is in there. How about something to the right of 10? 20. Okay. Any numbers that which fall in those regions will work. So we choose the test points, and now we're going to evaluate the zeroed and simplified thing from 2. Which is to say, we're going to take these test points and we're going to plug them into here. Into that thing. And we're only checking for sign, S-I-G-N. Which is to say, we're going to use the test point negative 20 first. If you evaluate the numerator at negative 20, what is the SIGN? Negative, right? Negative 20 plus 15 is negative. And now, negative 20 plugged into x minus 10 is also negative. So what we're saying is that the test point is telling us that in this region, expressions look like negative divided by negative. Okay, how about in the middle region? Our test point is 9. What is the SIGN of the numerator?
Positive.
Positive. And then the SIGN of the denominator? Negative. Okay, now at the test point 20. Over positive. So is there any question why the sign patterns look like this? Now, for each one of those patterns, we can determine the overall sign in that region. So we're saying that the expressions look like negative divided by negative. Well, what kind of thing is that?
Positive.
And in the middle? Negative. And in the rightmost region, positive. So is there any question about these? So would anyone care to speculate as to why this is called a sign chart? Because it's a chart full of signs, right? And that's how things get named in math class. Okay. So what we've done to this point is we took the number line, cut it into three pieces, and then we labeled each piece as being positive or negative. It so happened that there were three regions, and it so happened that they were labeled positive, negative, positive. But you could give me any number of regions, and you could say any incantation of the phrases of phrase using positive and negative, and I could make it be that way. I could make it be positive, positive, positive 48 times, and then negative, positive. I could do it. So now that we have this sign chart, we can make our conclusion. The answer to the question is we either want all of the positive regions or we want all of the negative ones. It's always going to be this way, either all the positives or all the negatives. On this specific exercise, do we want all of the positives or do we want all of the negatives? We want all of the negatives. Is that because we're negative people, or? Well, so we want the negative regions. And why the negative ones? There's an obvious reason once you see it.
Less than
It says that right there. It says, we want this thing that we worked so hard on to be less or equal to zero. So we want the negative regions.
So is it still based on zero and simplify, or do we go all the way back to the beginning?
That one.
Okay.
And to be clear, if I were to go back in time and edit the exercise so that that inequality is turned around the other way, if that one were turned around the other way, then so would all of these, including that one. And in such a case, we would want the positive regions. Okay. But we want the negative ones. Are there any negative regions?
Yes.
There are. The one in the middle, right? The one in the middle. So we want the middle region and nothing else. So we want the interval negative 15 to 10. But there's four intervals. The statement interval negative 15 to 10 is ambiguous because there's four possibilities. Which is to say, do you want the left endpoint or not? Do you want the right endpoint or not? So when we say the interval from negative 15 to 10, which one do we want? Do we include negative 15?
Yes.
Why do we include negative 15? Because it says less or equal to zero. Okay, if you were to plug in negative 15, that would be zero divided by negative 25, which is zero. Is zero less or equal to zero? It sure is. So I guess by the same logic, we also want 10 because it says less or equal. Ten's not in the natural domain, so 10 can't be included. Of course, you can see that if you were to attempt to plug this in right here, right? If you try and plug in 10, that would be 25 divided by 0. Well, you can't do that, so it can't be part of the solution. Any question about this? So now, let's be clear. Isn't this tedious? Wow. Now, that being said, the method is extremely powerful in the sense that as long as you follow this recipe and you don't make any careless errors in your algebra, you literally cannot fail. It's foolproof. Furthermore, the exercises that you'll be given will literally say, solve this using the sign chart method. So, supposing that you have a genie or an engineering friend or whatever, okay, they can just, you know, tell you the answer. That's terrific. But you won't receive credit unless you use the sign chart method. Okay? Good. Any question about this? So now, I showed a lot of steps and even wrote specific instructions, but that's because this is the first time. You can make it more compact than this. So let's do one more compactly. So solve with sign chart method. Okay, how about x squared minus 12x plus 32 greater than 0. Okay, what's the first step? Natural domain. Okay. What's the natural domain? All reals. Now, thinking ahead a few steps, we're going to make a sign chart. What does this imply about that sign chart? It means that we won't draw any of those fence posts because of this. Right? No fence posts are going to result from the domain. So on the previous exercise, we said that, well, you can have anything but 10, and as a result, we had to draw 10. This is saying that nothing is excluded, so there's no breaks. So none of the fence posts are a consequence of this.
What's the next step? Yeah, zero and simplify. Now, because of time pressure, in the end, I made this one pretty easy in the sense that, well, one of the sides is already zero. Right, so there's nothing to do for that. So x squared minus 12x plus 32 greater than zero. So I did it, right? I made one side zero. And by simplify, yes, factoring is the way to go. So can you factor that? How does it factor? Okay, very good. 4 and 8. Okay, so we zeroed and simplified the original inequality. So that's what I mean. Zero, simplify. Okay, what's the next step in the sign chart method? Solve the corresponding equation, which is to say x minus 4 multiplied by x minus 8 equal to 0. Well, what are the solutions? 4 and 8. Okay, what's the next step? The actual chart itself. So, there's no breaks in the domain. There's just the two solutions, 4 and 8.
Put something to the left of 4. About 3. And to the right, how about 5? And to the right of 8, how about 9?
So we're going to take these test points and we're going to put them into here.
So let's find the sign pattern. So if you plug in 3 into these two factors, what's the first one? If you plug in 3. So 3 minus 4 is... Yeah, all together, yes, but...
Okay, so negative 1.
Yeah,
negative
so...
Negative over negative times negative.
Negative times negative, good. And then if you plug in 5... It'd be positive times
negative.
And if you plug in 9, positive, positive, right? So is there any question why the pattern looks like this? Then the overall sign in each region would be positive and then negative. And then positive. Okay, so then now we're able to make a conclusion. So We took the real line and carved it into three pieces, and then labeled each piece as being positive or negative. It so happened that there were three pieces. It so happened that it was positive and then negative and then positive. We either want all of the positive regions or all the negative ones. We want the positive regions, but last time we wanted the negative ones. It's because of this step, right? Because they're right there. So we want the positive regions. Positive because that. So, are there any positive regions? There are, right? There's these two. And because they're disconnected, that means that you'll have to write it with a union. Okay? So, what are they? Bracket? Why bracket? Well, what if we plug 4 into there?
Oh, so it would be 0.
Right. So if we plug 4 in here, then that would be 0. It would read, that's 0, and it doesn't matter what that is, so it's all 0. 0 greater than 0. Well, is 0 greater than 0? It is not. So this should not be a bracket. It can't be included. To 4, and then what?
Union. Mm-hmm.
Very good. Right, so it's not included again because it says greater than. And I always include eights in my problems when there's going to be infinities because I just think it looks funny. Okay, so any question about this? So now, I'll let you in on a little secret. So first, to this prompt, this is the answer. You must write it more or less exactly in this way. Is it tedious? Yeah, of course it is. It is tedious. Now, I don't think about this exercise at all in my head it doesn't work this way at all. So by the end of next week, I hope that you'll be able to think about not only will you be able to do the sign chart method, which is important, but I want you to be able to think about it in a different way. So this is the answer, but I want you to consider the following. Well, that left hand side of the inequality, that's a quadratic. Right? It's a quadratic. What is the name of the shape of the plot of the graph of a quadratic? Which one is it? Parabola. That's the shape. So anytime you're thinking about a quadratic algebraically, when you want to think about it geometrically, there's a parabola involved. So here's a parabola. And then y equal to 0, that's a horizontal line. That's the x-axis, in fact. Now, where do you think the parabola and the x-axis intersect? At 4 and 8. And do you observe that the parabola is over the axis here, and then under, and then over? Over, under, over? Which means that the parabola is going to be positive here, negative here, and positive here. Which is, of course, exactly what this is saying. So in my mind's eye, when I made up this problem on the spot here, this is what I was imagining. Not all this business. So by the end of next week, say, but well, the week, not next week, right, because that's spring break. But by the end of the next week of lecture, I hope that you can think about these problems in both these ways. Okay, so have a nice Monday.